Hi, this is Rick Keene. Coming up, my interview with Gord, Gano, one half of the founding members of the Violent Femmes. A band that's been together since the 80s, one of the most popular alternative bands of all time. Looking forward to my conversation with Gord. They'll be here as part of the Montreal International Jazz Festival, and it should be one heck of a show, as these guys' live shows are legendary. Let's hope they have a whole bunch of horn players on stage with them. Thanks for listening to Rick Keene Music Scene. Hi, this is Rick Keene from Rick Keene Music Scene, and the Violent Femmes were one of the most popular, and still are one of the most popular alternative bands in music history, and I'm really honored to have Gordon Gano with me. Thanks for joining me, Gordon.
Hi, you're welcome.
I don't want to go into the past too much, but what was your mindset when you got together and formed the Femmes?
Oh, at the very beginning?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mindset was I've got a whole bunch of songs, and the only thing I want to do is to play these songs and to make music and make recordings and tour, and that's what I want my life to be. And I had met Brian Ritchie and Victor DiLorenzo, bass and drums. We had done some playing together, and we played a bit in when we had met. They were planning on moving away from where we met in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. They were planning to move to Minneapolis, Minnesota, and join some friends there and have a band. And then that didn't work out for them. I don't know why now. I'm not sure if I ever knew, or I'm sure I forgot. But we were liking the music we were making together a lot, so we decided to keep doing it. I was going to play my songs with somebody somewhere. I thought I was going to move to New York City and get started there, because I was born there and I always had family there, and I thought that's where I would go and have a band and play the punk rock clubs and take it from there. But it started up in Wisconsin and with other people, and we thought we had a sound, and we had something that was just musically was something was happening with it that was very good. So we stuck with that, and we're still stuck with it.
I need someone, a person to talk to, someone who care to love. Could it be you? Could it be you? Situation gets rough, then I start to panic. It's not enough, it's just the habit. A kid, you're sick. Well, darling, this is it. You can all just kiss off into the air. Behind my back, I can see them stare. They'll hurt me bad, but I won't mind. They'll hurt me bad, they do it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they do it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
They do it all the time. They do it all the time.
They do it all the time.
They do it all the time.
Do it all the time.
I hope you know that this will go down on your permanent record. Oh yeah? Well, don't get so distressed. Did I happen to mention that I'm impressed?
So when you guys formed and got together, who were you listening to?
Oh, there's a lot of stuff. I think an obvious one, not just for us, but for so many people, the Velvet Underground, especially the first album, and, well, all of them, really, but that comes to mind. Something that might be a surprise is a big influence on our beginnings was Sun Ra, the jazz musician. I don't know if you're familiar with him, but I think everybody should be. A lot of jazz influence, and even with Sun Ra, it was also about the performance. Something about it that really was a big thing for all of us.
Well, I'm trying to acquaint them with outer space things. Yeah. Other planets have culture, dances that are unusual, music, and that's what I'm trying to get the planet ready for space beings, because they're sure to land soon.
Of the punk rock nature, or punk rock in a large way of saying, because then certain music is so different. I know Brian Ritchie was one of his favorites, and still, and also mine is Television. Then there's also, for me especially, Johnny Thunders and the Heartbreakers were a huge thing for me at that time. The Ramones, I think, for all of us. And obviously, we're starting to make a list. I'm just leaving out more people than I'm mentioning. I mean, we were all passionate and still are about music and just listen to music all the time.
And so, but that whole mentality back then and even now, it's always been caked in rebelliousness. Do you still have that kind of mainframe or like that mindset?
I don't know. Interesting question. I'm not quite sure what the answer is. I mean, certainly some things feel different, but I don't know about that. I'm not sure.
Well, I mean, to obviously be still playing after all these years, I mean, it's not about the money anymore, right? It's all about the music.
Well, it's always about the music. Then you mentioned the money, which often gets thought of in a negative way. Everybody has to make a living and has to be able to feed themselves and their family and everything like that. So I don't see it as necessarily a bad thing. It's necessary. There's certain kinds of music that we do which is able to make some money, and largely all the music that all of us do doesn't make any money at all. So it's nice to have some that makes some money, and that's Violent Femmes. Violent Femmes can, for example, I'm talking to you because there's a promoter who said, I want to have Violent Femmes come play. And that involves being able to help us make a living, and that's I'm very thankful for that, and that's a great thing.
Right. Well, I didn't bring the money issue up in a bad way. I was just basically saying that, you know, the music is the thing that keeps musicians going, basically.
Oh, absolutely, and yeah, maybe I overreacted with that because you probably, you know, in a lot of times in so many contexts that people do bring up money related to, I think, the arts of any sort in with a negative idea about it. So perhaps I was already hearing it like that, even though you didn't state it like that. So
right.
Yeah, but yeah, the passion for the music is there and always has been, and I'm sure always will be. I can't remember a time in my life when I wasn't in love with music, really. I was making up songs. I can only remember maybe one of them or so, but I was told as soon as I could talk at all, I was making up songs and singing songs. So it goes back even pre-memory for me. It was about music.
Well, I'm reading this poem and it's so profound, and I like its rhythm and I like its sound by a very famous poet. No crit can criticize, and then I pause a moment and I start to realize he's telling lies, 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 lies.
Well, you know, I had a chance, I think it was 2 years ago now, I spent about 4 or 5 hours with Glenn Matlock and Scott Kempner from The Dictators.
Right.
And I was just hanging around with those guys, and just, you know, because they were, you know, amongst the forefathers of punk rock, and just hanging around with them, and they were playing a small club here in Montreal, and they, you know, the love, and they did an acoustic show together, and just the love on stage that you could see, it was just unbelievable. And when I listen to you guys, I get that same feeling.
Well, that's great. That's really wonderful.
Yeah, and speaking of the Sex Pistols, were they a huge influence?
Oh, they were something that we all enjoyed. I think that for all of us, the influence was probably more from the influences that were on the Sex Pistols, such as the punk rock scene and the music, at least as I understood it, coming from the U.S. and then England took it and did their version of it. You know, much like so many kinds of American music, of blues and jazz and so forth, R&B. You know, the people there taking that music and then giving it their own flavor, kind of an imitation, but also then with a different kind of something else to it as well. And I think that was happening a lot with punk rock and also Sex Pistols. Again, as the little bit I understand, I'm not an expert on it, but was that a lot of it was at least designed to be about fashion and things other than exactly the music. And then, as a friend of mine has said, it just so happened that the Sex Pistols just happened to make incredibly amazing, great music. But that wasn't even the initial intention by the original plan. I should stop talking because I'm like talking all about the Sex Pistols, and I know really I haven't even read a book on them. It's just things I've picked up here and there.
No, but you're exactly right though, because that's it. They started off and it was a shock act basically, and then everything else kind of just it's a really bizarre story, the Sex Pistols.
Influence.
Well, you know, it's funny because when you guys started and got together, the music was one way, and then by the time your third album around 1987 or so, the whole music industry was changing because of videos and the money involved. So you guys were right along for that ride. How did you find from like say 1980 to 1990? You must have went, wow, what just happened?
No, because it's just everything's in flux, everything's changes, and everything. I think things have probably, there's an argument that could be made that things have been changing. You mentioned the time period that you just did, and I think it's a strong argument to say the change has been bigger of the more recent years, and maybe will continue to be bigger, most likely, almost certainly will continue to be bigger as things go forward. So I didn't really think about that. I also recall from years ago, I remember watching a late night television show where Ringo Starr was a guest. And Ringo Starr was asked, you've been in the business so many years and from your early start with the Beatles and now how everything is, you know, changed, and how is it all, like when you do a show, how has that all changed for you with all these, you know, years and all the changes in the music business? And as I recall, Ringo's answer was, nothing has changed. You get in, you do the gig, you get out. And I, you know, so it comes into my mind. It's not exactly the question you were asking, but for me, things feel, anyway, to me, more the same than different, even if I recognize that I could be being, you know, just ill-informed about a lot of things. But the changes of the time period you mentioned, yeah, the videos. I remember MTV played our first video, Gone Daddy Gone, a lot because they didn't have enough videos to fill up all the time that they had. So they just wanted anything and everything from anybody.
This lovely girl, cause to me she mean all the world, but then she like another guy. I fall down dead, she never see the tears I cry. Said please, please, please do not go. Might make a turn either way. So all I can do is patiently pray. Say, please, please, please do not go.
Time period, and it didn't change again in that I don't know if they show any music videos anymore, but anyway, so there's kind of a random answer.
Well, in other words, the more things change, the more they stay the same.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, you can just just condense it and just say that, sure.
And that concludes my interview, part one, with Gord Gano of the Violent Femmes. They're going to be here as part of the Montreal International Jazz Festival. Stay tuned for part two of my interview with Gord. It's an amazing story, and it only gets better in part two, trust me. Thanks for listening to Rick Keene Music Scene, brought to you by the House of Jazz. Johnny Bodine is there on Monday, Snooksta and the Gangstas on Wednesday, Tory Butler Thursday and Saturday, as well as many other performers. Go to thehouseofjazz.ca and check out their schedule. Also, don't forget, Strangers of the Night 10, June 14th at Fairview Center, Point Claire. Go to strangersinthenight.ca, buy your tickets. It all goes to the Starlight Children's Foundation. It's for a great cause, so all these little kids can get their dreams come true. This year features the Pointer Sisters. So thanks again for listening to Rick Keene Music Scene. Talk soon.
You're listening to Rick Keene's Music Scene. Rick can be heard every Friday at 5:15 with Sean McKeel on K103.7 FM.